Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and other public television stations. The Mobile Corporation, Dow Chemical Company, John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated, Laurel Foundation, Sunstrand Corporation, and the Friends of Firing Line.
Relatively long history of this program entering its 19th year, only one guest has appeared seven times, and he is Malcolm Muggeridge. One program in which he explored the search for faith is regularly shown on Christmas week. I hope it is shown well after I am departed, perhaps even after he has departed. He has for many years spoken of himself as an old man, which at 82 he technically is, when reminded that at age 90 Harold Macmillan was made an earl. Mr. Muggeridge responded that now he knew for sure that he had nothing to live for. After almost 4 years, we are back in the home of Mr. and Mrs. Muggeridge in Sussex. The last program done here inquired first into the search for faith and in the second hour to the question of denominationalism. He asked, in fact, that we call the hour Why I Am Not a Catholic. 26 months after the program was shown, he and his wife went to a neighboring church and were baptized. He was asked why by a press always fascinated by the most distinguished living alumnus, and he spoke of, I quote, a sense of homecoming, of picking up the threads of a lost life, of responding to a bell that has long been ringing, of finding a place at a table that has long been left vacant. I suppose we should touch on what it was that he now heard in the tone of that bell before moving on to explore a relatively recent phenomenon, namely the rise of Christian pacifism, particularly, or so it would sometimes seem, in America within the Catholic Church. So, I begin by asking the question directly, what, Mr. Muggeridge, did you now hear in the tintinnabulation of the bells?
Well, instead of the bell sounding and as something that I couldn't respond to, now I hear it with joy because it means that I go to Mass. And this has been, in old age, a wonderfully fulfilling thing. I think it's just partly good fortune because the little chapel in which we were received, now we go there, and it's packed with children, and I love to have the Mass with all these little children round, and come away feeling enormously happy.
Well, but why was it that this could not have been anticipated earlier? I asked this question not to tease you, but out of a genuine curiosity. You said 4 years ago that you were afraid of entering into any discipline in which you would find yourself instantly in the role of a critic, more so even than a communicant. What was it that altered that?
Just because the experience itself, Bill, did. That's all I can say, is that it's one of the things in my life, perhaps uniquely really, which I have no sort of qualification to make. That worship is a beautiful thing and a thing that I missed for many years. And now I enjoy very much this morning, for instance, rather thinking of you, as a matter of fact, and of this. Kitty and I went off to Mass. And it obviously, it is this ancient ritual. I read somewhere in a book recently, which perhaps shed a little bit of light on it, that since the Last Supper, there has never been an hour has never passed in which there's not someone in the world giving and receiving the sacrament. And it's an amazing thought, that all the terrible things that have happened and the confusion, and yet this is something that has gone on and goes on now, and I can participate in it.
Well, you mentioned in our discussion last time around a second point, namely that the resurgence of faith behind the Iron Curtain reminded one of the special stimulus of catacomb life. Do you reiterate that now that you still live on the correct side of the Iron Curtain and have an opportunity to worship and to receive the sacraments? Do you feel that you are missing something, for instance, that the Pole has got, or the Ukrainian Christian, or the Czechoslovak?
I don't think so, no. Although what I said then has been only strengthened in what I've heard and read and very limited way experienced, that there is, that strangely enough, the Christian religion is disintegrating in the Western world without any question, but that it is in some mysterious manner growing in power and influence where you wouldn't perhaps least expect it, which is in these labor camps. And a conversation that I had with Solzhenitsyn recently, who of course is very well versed in what goes on in the gulag, he makes this point very strongly, that this, that in abolishing the Christian faith, the regime has really restored it, and that where this suffering takes place, where people are utterly cut off from everything that would normally be thought of making life worth living, there this amazing hope is reborn.
Well, there is, of course, a temptation to find a divine purpose in everything. I think that temptation should presumptively be resisted. But this does, what you the phenomenon to which you allude tempts one to ask whether we might be, in fact, heading towards towards apocalypse. It has struck me that the recognition of the world's end is a cliche in Christian doctrine, and yet it strikes me that as that possibility becomes increasingly vivid, there is a fear of it that is inconsistent with that philosophical detachment in which it was accepted 2,000 years ago. Does that strike you also?
I think there's a tremendous lot in that. I mean, the God knows the necessary forces and scenario is available for such a ending. It's the first time in human history that men have in their hands the means of bringing the world to an end. Of course, I don't actually think they would bring it to an end. I mean, I think they might think they had, but...
I don't want you to predict it.
No.
More than I would want to do so.
No, but I don't think that... I think that it is part of this experience of living that you see this potential of an end, but that actually there can't be an end. And that the circumstances which would bring about the end could also bring about the beginning. In other words, putting in very simple terms, imagine that we do have the lunacy of a great atomic explosion, a nuclear explosion. The enormous destruction will take place, enormous numbers of deaths will occur. But also somewhere or other, somebody will be just... suddenly prostrating themselves before some coloured stone or something, and the door begins again.
Yes, as that hack Russian writer once wrote, that when all the world is paved in concrete, somewhere a blade of grass will
come through. That's right.
However, let's look at it a little bit
more totally, if you don't mind, on the understanding, this is an abstract exercise. Carl Sagan, the American scientist, has recently popularized, if that's right, with the intuition that, in fact, if 3,000 whatever, megabytes or unmegabytes or kilobytes or whatever, go off, it will cause a cosmic winter which will make survival absolutely impossible. Mm. When he told me this, I gave perhaps the wrong reply. Spastically, I said, well, that's very good news, because I should think that would be the ultimate deterrent to that kind of a trigger being pressed. But in any case, as you began by saying, and I think it's correct, that technically the means do exist to blot out life, including the blade of grass. Now, why should we resist, as our churchmen seem to have done, an attempt to integrate that hypothetical contingency in Christian doctrine?
Well, largely for one reason, and one reason alone, which to me is absolutely decisive, and that is that ultimately the only prayer there is to say is, thy will be done. And therefore, if something can happen, and if that something happens, it can only be part of the purpose of our Creator for his creation. And that it might seem to be utterly destructive and hopeless, but out of it would come some continuation, possibly not even in this particular planet, of the creation. And this is, even if the whole thing were to be obliterated, still that would be God's purpose. Otherwise it couldn't happen.
No, here wouldn't the theologians insist that God's purpose be defined as giving to man the will which can mischievously be exerted to the end of suicide?
Yes.
Right, but it's not necessarily, if somebody commits suicide, it's not God's purpose that he should commit suicide, is it?
No, but the fact that it happens means that God willed it to happen.
God willed that we have the power to have it.
And if we had that power, that he also willed that in certain circumstances we might use that power. And our resultant situation would be, in that sense, what he's conceived should be brought about.
But the proximate pressure would be the devil's rather than God's, would it not?
The pressure might be the devil's, and to some extent would be the devil, but you see, even the devil's purposes are ultimately turned into God's purpose. It was the devil's purpose that our Lord should be crucified. But in his crucifixion lay everything that's wonderful in a civilization that you and I belong to. If that is now going to destroy itself, it can only destroy itself not necessarily with God's approval, but with God's consent. And therefore, out of it will come something which is impossible to foresee, some life far away, or some life in the wreckage will suddenly manifest itself, and the whole process will begin.
Oh, a transmutation of life into something different.
Yes, could be.
Okay, well now let's focus on the phenomenon of the end of the world and ask whether it has had an unhealthy bearing on a number of priests and theologians of every Christian denomination who seem to be approaching Christian pacifism, which was never a traditional position in Christianity. Do you find that the bishop's statement, for instance, in America that made so much so many headlines a year or so ago, that sometimes had a taste of idolatry for life in this world, in the sense that it was given a priority which it was never intended to have?
Well, I think that is so. I think that is so, that it is a lack of humility. in quarters where there should be no lack of humility. That it's saying that this is the most appalling thing, and if this happens, then everything is lost. But everything can't be lost, because we are part of this creation, and what happens to us is in some degree, in some particular, the fulfilling of God's purpose for his creation. And I think that these bishops have been infected with what is the great sickness of the 20th century, which is science. They've caught that illness, and a lot of the things that they've done, which are distressing if you look into them, is because they've caught that illness, or this idiotic thing of evolution, which I'm sure will amuse mankind or whoever succeed mankind for centuries to come. This idea that there was an amoebic mess, and this amoebic mess became Bertrand Russell or somebody like that.
I can believe that.
Yes. This is a sort of craziness that science has fed into life and produced an inanity which no previous supposition has. So I don't think... I mean, the hierarchy are disgracing themselves quite often by falling into that trap.
Well, as I understand it, here is the distinction that they attempt to make. They say, all right, it is correct that Christianity has never adopted a pacifism, certainly not the Catholic Church, i.e. they have accepted the notion that some things are worth dying for in pursuit of, not suicide, but in pursuit of, let's say, in pursuit of safety for your family, you may venture out and expose yourself to the possibility of death. Now, what's different now, say they, or say many of them, is that the corporate decision, of which I gave a particular example, is one that holds hostage the survival of the human race, and that the stakes, therefore, are too great to justify going out to protect the safety of the hearth, which means going out with hydrogen bombs and perhaps this 300 megatons or whatever it is that's sufficient to destroy the Earth. This, they say, is a quantum jump away from the conventional understanding of Christian hierarchy, and for that reason, some of them are finding themselves uttering pacifist pieties, which really call for unilateral surrender. Now, do you see anything in the fact of the bomb that invalidates preceding thinking as it touches on Christian pacifism?
Well, I think that part of the fallacy of their position is seeing this bomb as a unique threat.
Why is that a fallacy?
Well, because it's not a unique threat. I mean, because mankind has been under attack in various ways throughout his history. I was looking through the other day, and in the Lateran Council in the 12th century, a resolution was taken that the crossbow was such an evil, monstrous weapon that no Christian should use it. It could, however, be used against heathens, but not against Christians. This diabolical weapon, and multiply that by a billion, 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 and you have the atomic bomb. But
do you? You see, they say that's not true. They say you're using a synecdoche when you talk about one man with a crossbow. Mm. But say they, when the target is life itself. You've got to usher in more sophisticated rules. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm anxious to hear your analysis of why that isn't so.
Well, it isn't so because, in fact, it's not a difference in kind. It's a difference in degree. You see, for instance, because my memory goes back a long way now, and in all the prognostications about the 39-45 war, where that's the aeroplanes will always get through, saturation bombing will take place, we're all going to be destroyed. In fact, they, as human beings always do, produce some very bizarre ideas. One was that there should be an enormous store of coffins available. And it sounds like I'm making it up, but I'm not. And there weren't enough wood for all the coffins that would be required by this Holocaust, so they had cardboard coffins.
But they were more nearly right than wrong, weren't they? The deaths in World War I were 15 million. In the Second World War, 55 million. Mm. And leading up to Hiroshima.
Yes.
So wouldn't you say that there was a certain amount of prophetic validity in what they talked about?
Not really, no, because I think that it presupposes that this miserable, ridiculous little creature, Homo sapiens, will be able to destroy totally God's creation, and he won't. That's all. I mean, Hiroshima, again, is a very good example. It so happened that I went there very soon after the end of the war in a train with the emperor, because General MacArthur told the emperor that he wasn't a sun god anymore. He was simply an ordinary king, and he must wear a trilby hat and raise it and so on.
He's just a frumpy and bizarre banal king.
Absolutely. Well, then we got to Hiroshima, and then this is this place of doom. But, of course, it wasn't a place of doom. And, you know, the only man I ever met who actually lived through the bomb in Hiroshima was the late head of the Jesuits, Ariba. He was a priest there.
I didn't know that.
And I asked him about all these different things, the sort of black rain and all these things that were built up, you know, in the picture. You're in that single issue of the New Yorker brought it all out. And of course, it was a very, very bad explosion. Very destructive explosion.
But Mrs. Muggeridge, I don't think you don't intend to communicate, or do you, that we are exaggerating the apocalyptic powers of the existing inventory of weapons. If whoever it was counted is correct, we have 600 million times the explosive power of the Hiroshima bomb in our current inventories.
Yes. Bill, I don't take those figures. I mean, they're true, but the implications of them are not true. If there is a nuclear bomb, a nuclear explosion that destroys everything, if there is one single black man in the middle of some huge jungle, still alive, then it hasn't destroyed mankind. It'll begin again, it'll go on. I mean, it's the idea that this thing that we've got will in fact obliterate the human race, and that too, again, is only obliterating the occupants of one very small little feature in the universe. And to regard that as the end of everything is the mad ego that develops.
Well, it may be just a little acre, but it's our planet's little acre.
It is our planet. I'm very fond of it in a way. I mean,
why do you seem to resist, for reasons that aren't plain to me yet, the notion that in fact it is written that the end of the world will come.
It could come, at any rate, it could come in human terms. I don't think that it could come in God's terms, because it's all, the whole idea is built not upon God's purpose, but upon man's purpose. And man's purpose is always wrong.
Well, it was certainly wrong in crucifying him, but in fact, people seem to be arguing, even people whose roots are in Christian thought, that although the New Testament does speak about the end of the world, such a thing is really inconceivable. Mm-hmm. And that under the circumstances, all policy should be written around preventing that possibility, and that the shrewdest way to do that is to destroy even unilaterally our nuclear inventory. Mm. Which to me is lunatic and heretical in its implications, but I don't want to argue with them that they may in fact be right, that the next time around not even one black man in Africa will survive, or one blade of grass.
Mm. Well, of course, we can't really decide, you know, exactly what's going to happen, but there is an element of scientific egotism and pride built into the idea that having invented this thing, life's over, if used. Mm-hmm. This is an absolutely typical madness of the scientific mind. I don't think that is at all what the end of the world, as envisioned by people like the Apostle Paul, was.
What did he have in mind?
What he had in mind was the coming again of our Lord.
Uh-huh.
That was the essential thing, and that would be more important and more sublime than anything that human beings could do. I mean, that was what the end of the world was, the end of the reign of man, and that that Christ would come again, and life would be quite different. Now, this is a dream, but it's a very beautiful dream, and I don't think that it can be equated in any way with the use of an ultra-powerful nuclear bomb, which will, of course, do enormous damage. The other day, the Pope said something. He's a good man, that Pope, and he every now and again says terribly good things. And he said the trouble with this nuclear thing is not really the bomb. The trouble is that there should be men who would use the bomb. Mm-hmm. That's the terrible thing, and that's the devil's thing. I quite agree. I think he's absolutely right.
I think it's absolutely right, and I think it's correct that people forget that. James Burnham pointed out years ago in his seminal book that a rifle is no more deadly than a broomstick.
Exactly.
In the absence of the will to use it as a rifle. But we do know that there are people alive who would not cavil at the use of the bomb if, in fact, it could be guaranteed to bring about what it was that they sought to bring about. Now, is there in the net dialectical situation an argument for throwing away our atom bombs?
Well,
on Christian principle,
I don't think at this moment that there is. There could be. It could come a time when it might seem right to do it, but now I think that the one hope of preventing this not apocalypse, but the total destruction of everything that we call Western civilization means the world, that would happen, because the only way let me go to a sort of frightfully small point. Really, I happened to be in America when the Cuban crisis was on, and there was old Khrushchev and John F. Kennedy meeting together, and you could see exactly that each of them was thinking, you know, well, he's got this, and we don't want to have it. In other words, they didn't want a nuclear war, and there wasn't a nuclear war. You could have, of course, a situation in which the person who's Khrushchev does want it, because he thinks that owing to all this peace business that is being stirred up, that a decisive victory could be won by the communist powers. That is possibly true, but I don't think that you could have sort of two. If you have two relatively equal nuclear force potential, that is a situation which is not terribly dangerous. It becomes dangerous if one of them becomes so weak that the temptation to the other to use its superiority would be there.
Well, is that the imaginary situation in which you said you might make the point that Christian duty prescribed throwing away your nuclear arsenal?
I don't think that it implies that.
Well, what did you have in mind when you said under some circumstances that might be?
Well, that might be the case that this that there could be an agreement, a real agreement, not a faked agreement, but a real agreement to get rid of this in exactly the same way that at a much lower level, the danger of poison gas, the danger of bacteriological war.
Yeah, but that's not unilateral, if there's an agreement, is there?
No, it's not, but it is...
So you're not really anxious to specify a circumstantial situation in which you would recommend, as a Christian, that we unilaterally do away...
In the present setup of the world, no. I think that it's absolutely foolish notion, which has been largely stimulated by people who want to make sure that the East is the strong side. Mm-hmm. And those people are working away like beavers. We have a local Monsignor here who lends himself to this. It's one of the few changes that take place, because when before it was the Dean of Canterbury, an Anglican, but now we have a Monsignor who says that the communists, for instance, are men of peace.
Well. So like the Red Dean 25 years ago.
That's right. He reappears as a Monsignor.
Mm-hmm. Well, I suppose to say you're a man of peace in the generic sense is not to commit an empirical error. But if you point at Stalin and say this was a man of peace, it's extremely difficult to carry that metaphor, isn't it?
Bill, there is a peace, and funnily enough, in meditating on all this business, it came to me rather vividly because rather a strange thing happened. When we were trying to get the Nobel Peace Prize for Mother Teresa, which we had to several years in succession to get, and then she finally got it, the question came back from Oslo, which is where the thing is settled, by these rather somber Norwegian senators who decide who is the person of peace, that the question came back is, what does Mother Teresa do for peace? In other words, where does she sort of march and recite slogans and hold hands around missile sites and so on and so on? What has she done for peace?
She gives a sense of priority.
Yes. Well, the point is that she lives in the opposite proposition.
That's right.
These two great forces in our existence of power and love, she is the one who lives in terms of love. Now, that is really working for peace. That is really overcoming the menace of people who are going to destroy totally our world and ourselves. But it struck me as very humorous in a way that somebody should think, well, we should want to be given some point in her activities which you could say that is definitely in the direction of peace. And I suppose the people who put that question, if she had actually joined in this so-called peace movement,
yes,
that would have met the case.
Yes, yes.
But
yes.
Of course, it's much more than that.
Yeah.
And in her, one can see why the Christian can confront the danger of a nuclear holocaust without undue fear.
Well, surely in the case of Mother Teresa, you have an example of somebody who is carrying out so explicitly the injunction that she should love her neighbors, as to entitle you to say, if everybody loved their neighbors as she loves her neighbors, you could not crank up the kind of hostility that would bring on belligerence.
Exactly.
Do you acknowledge or not the following line of reasoning, namely that if in a nuclear exchange, the victim of the first strike, in this case the West, were to proceed to fire back, although it's too late
according to my accounting, to prevent that first strike. You don't necessarily repeal the doctrine of deterrence because you have accomplished something in virtue of firing back and ridding the world of such aggressors as committed the first strike. Do you have a moral justification, in other words, in firing back with the sole purpose of ridding the world of such aggressors? That's the question.
Yes, well, I think that it's a matter which I couldn't in advance say that...
But you would have to if you were president, wouldn't you?
Yes, you would have to envisage the possibility of that.
We intend to run you, you know.
Yes, you would have to do that. And it's certainly very important that the people who are going to send the first shot mm-hmm. know quite
exactly,
well
exactly.
that this one is coming back, because that is the best of all deterrents,
yeah, right.
actually.
And in the absence of that certitude, yes. deterrent, there's an attrition of the deterrent
yes,
factor.
Increases enormously the danger of the thing being precipitated from one quarter. That is indeed true.
Yeah.
And so that the pacifism, in the sense of saying that we will get rid of all our weapons, well, yes, if you are prepared to have no authority in the world, no influence in the world, no importance in the world, you wind up your role as a country, as a people. That is one sort of pacifism, and it's one that I could bring myself to respect. But the idea that you would give up your nuclear weapons and then whoever gets over his illness and can function in the Kremlin would then say, well, it's not much good us having any nuclear weapons if these people have given them up. That is pure drivel, isn't it?
Yeah. C.S. Lewis said that the pacifists have a vested interest in losing their campaign because
yes.
because the belligerents would not permit them to be pacifists. And under the circumstances, they can only continue to be pacifists for so long as they lose the popular campaign. Pacifists are not tolerated in the Soviet Union. Under the circumstances, the sure way to guarantee that you would end your pacifist existence would be to surrender to the Soviet Union. So... although that point sometimes sounds a little bit too trim and neat, I think it is a profoundly interesting point. Now, when you speak of the disintegration of Christian life, do you mean exclusively among the laity or also among the clergy?
Well, I mean both, mm-hmm. actually.
So is there not visible... a resistance to that disintegration among the organized clergy?
I suspect there might be. I haven't actually come across it myself, mm-hmm. but I suspect there might be, because the clergy are subject to the fantasies of human beings, and that's one.
I know a scholar who years ago said, you know, I've been dying to become a Catholic for about 10 or 12 years, but I can't get anybody interested enough to tell me about it. And I thought that was extremely interesting.
Very interesting, yes.
The notion that it has a very low priority, i.e. that religious evangelism should have a very low social priority, is really quite new, or is it? Is that a 20th century phenomenon?
I'm not quite sure what you mean by that.
Well, in most centuries, people had what they called fighting faiths. And although they were often stupid about how they attempted to evangelize, the Inquisition being a notorious example, still they cared. And the question arises whether in the 20th century people care enough to bother, for instance, to preach the word of Christ, even at the risk of being boring. Hmm. Is that a part of the disintegration that you isolate, that lack of zest?
I would think it probably is, but I still am not quite sort of clear myself as to exactly what's in their minds over that. I think that it could be regarded as a sort of deterioration, as a loss of of faith, in a way. After all, the ultimate faith of the Christian religion is that God is responsible for creation, and God is a God of love and not of hate. God is a love of, is all the qualities that we want to see in the world, and that nothing can be settled except in relation to that. Man can make an inconceivable mess of everything, and I would say that he's putting up a tremendous performance at this moment, partly by this utter acceptance of the idea that this bomb makes nothing worthwhile.
Well, when we pray that we be delivered from temptation, might it be correct to say that a temptation in having a nuclear arsenal is to use it, even if your motives are defensive rather than aggressive, and that under the circumstances it is prudent to remove such a temptation from yourself, well, of course, being a
that
country.
Would be quite a good idea, provided you, the people who put it forward, will recognize exactly what that would mean. They would get rid of all their weapons. They would then count for absolutely nothing in the world. They would be of no importance whatever. They would have no influence whatever upon what happened. And if they reached that point, and after all, there are countries that have, small countries, like Scandinavian countries, that haven't really got any defenses and who seem to get along all right for the time being. I think that the notion that we must get rid of all this, these weapons, at all costs, and that if we do, we shall live happily ever after, is a great fantasy, and one that is planted on us to some extent by pressures that really are quite different but don't admit to being so.
Now, are those pressures, do they emanate from people who simply are unrealistic, or do they emanate from people who are sentimental about the Soviet Union? Somebody said about you that the only sense in which you have been fearfully consistent is your opposition to communism ever since you discovered it in Moscow in 1932. Is this consistency of opposition to communism by you something that derives from a special knowledge of communism, or is it generally communicable among people who haven't had your experience?
Well, obviously, it exists because of that experience, which for me was a great sort of turnover of views about life. And it was intensified by the spectacle, which is one of the, I still think, is one of the strangest of all that one's experienced, which is the spectacle of the choice intelligentsia of the Western world prostrating themselves before Stalin and his setup there.
And how do you account for that?
Well, I account for that that I mean, it's, of course, there are different features of it, but I think that the lot of the people who went there, and some of whom were known to me, and even through marriage related, that what they wanted to feel was that they could have power, absolute power, without going through all the rigmarole of being elected and making their views acceptable.
But why do they want the power?
Because they love power. Because people who have not realized that the basis of human life is love do love power and pine for power.
Well, do they in some cases pine for power because they feel that they can genuinely make a better world through the exercise of it?
They persuade themselves of that.
Yes.
It's rather like someone attempting a seduction and saying that after all this will do you good, you know. I mean, they are absolutely avid for power, for power's own sake. This is something that's in human beings, and it is enormously evident in ideologues. And then they see this Western set up in the USSR, and where, you know, everything can be done because you're completely free to do what seems to you right.
Well, but still, the search for power by Marcus Aurelius would be different from the search for power by Caligula, right?
Mm.
So you would distinguish between certain qualities of appetite, wouldn't
Certainly,
you?
Certainly, I would. But basically, the urge for power is a very dangerous one. It's one that Jesus Christ declined to have.
But certainly if you were, let's say, being tormented by Hitler in the 30s, you would welcome power sufficient to resist, wouldn't you?
That's what a war's about, isn't it?
Yeah. But you, let's say, a contender, a political contender for office in 1932, would desire power perhaps for the best of reasons.
He would think they were the best of reasons.
Uh-huh. But it would corrupt.
Yes, and it would be also something that he that appealed to him. In other words, instead of having to argue with a lot of difficult people and address a lot of meetings and things, he would be in a position to do what he thought was the right thing on his own strength. And so you had these. That was the only explanation I could see for all these extraordinary people coming there, and because everything in the regime and in the way in which it operated was contrary to what they believed in and liked. But they it still had the marvelous point in its favor that it gave you absolute power. I don't know, it's a very small example, but we were taken down to the Dnipro Dam when it was unveiled, or whatever it is, when it was finished. And there was an American colonel who had been building it. And I asked him, purely a sort of conversation, he said, how do you like it here? Expecting some marvelous tirade. And he said, oh, it's absolutely superb. And so I said, why do you think it's important? He said, well, because, you see, we never have any labor trouble. And that seemed to me to embody the whole thing. I mean, from his, it was perfect. You were building a dam, you wanted 1,000 more people, telephone to the GPU, and they come, no questions asked, no pay discussions.
What Michael Oakeshott calls making politics as the crow flies.
Yes.
The scholastic Christian philosophy teaches us that government is a divine institution. What do you understand to be meant by that assertion?
I've never met a government that seemed to me to be a divine institution, I'm afraid. But it is true that some men have to accept, I mean, power has to be exercised, and which is presumably is what Jesus Christ meant when he said, we render unto Caesar the things that are Caesar, and unto God the things that are God.
So therefore things should be, there are some things that should be Caesar's.
Exactly.
Yeah. For instance, a police force, right?
Yes.
That guards innocent people from free enterprise ravage.
Yes. They're all dangerous even then, but they're also necessary. But, I mean, he does, in answering that question about should we pay tribute to Caesar, he does recognize that Caesar has claims upon us if we enjoy the security
that he gives you.
That he gives us.
Yeah. And that would translate nowadays, for instance, in the right to conscript an army in England or in
to
America.
To limit what's called freedom under certain circumstances.
Yeah. And but the quest for power in democratic circumstances, you are saying, is self-governing. That is to say, you run less of a risk of accumulating as much of it as you would if you didn't have the democratic tribunal to pass.
Let
me then finish in the last 5 minutes that we have by asking you to sum up on this point. Is there anything that's happened in your lifetime which you think affects those priorities on the basis of which Christianity for 2,000 years has told us that there is such a thing as a just war?
I think this is a question that I find great difficulty in giving a sort of yes and no answer to. But certainly, I mean, again, in one's own personal life, in 1939, it seemed to me right that we should fight Hitler, that if we were to abandon Europe to Hitler, this would be an appalling thing. Afterwards, when it turned out that, in fact, by knocking off Hitler, we simply abandoned ourselves to Stalin, I felt less enthusiastic about it. But it is true that there is such a thing as a just war. There are circumstances in which, if you are going to maintain your civilized way of life, you may have to defend it. And if not, all you can do is to say that I'm not prepared to defend it. I don't think that these weapons and things should be used, and therefore I recognize that I must give up every idea of being secure in my way of life and being looked after in any way.
As you know, or you may not know, there is a protocol in gambling houses, and that protocol is that you may not be given credit. Now, some people do anyway. The idea there is that you should put up only as many chips as you can actually commandeer through the exercise of your financial resources, but otherwise you end up gambling your house and your children's education money and whatever. Now, in a sense, that's something that invokes proportionality. There are people, Christian theologians, who are saying that that proportionality that governed the idea of the just war is now out of bounds, that the kind of credits, the chips with which you were given up until the discovery of the nuclear bomb were realizable, whereas you now have a dimension that would be the equivalent of total credit. You don't believe, for instance, in your right to gamble your own soul, or do you?
It's a very good image, actually, of the whole thing. I see the difficulty. And
but you're not pronouncing on it.
I am pronouncing on it in this sense, that if a person is ready to say that because this bomb and a nuclear war would be so terrible, I herewith give up all idea of securing my property,
my family,
of looking after anything. I give it up because it seems to me that the price to be paid if it's nuclear war is too great.
You as an individual or you as a corporate state?
Well, first of all, as an individual, and then insofar as you influence the state, yes, also as a state.
We call this Finlandization.
Yes, but even that's a cheat, because the Finns are not quite utterly in the hands of the communists.
But that's by sufferance of the communists, isn't it?
Well, it is in a way, but they've also rather cunning themselves. I mean, I think that and the Russians use it, of course. They've let it be like that, which doesn't matter to them one way or the other, in order that they can use that argument.
Sure, it's like China letting Hong Kong be
as
it
is.
That's
right.
But it is by sufferance. Mm. Now, if one were offered by some divine arbiter the exchange of life as it is lived in Finland, i.e. with as many freedoms as they have and none other, one might say, well, this is better than risking a nuclear exchange. Mm. On the other hand, there would be no guarantee, would there?
No. And this is exactly what's happening, actually, because the Germans, I mean, the next move in this game, unless there's trouble inside the USSR, is that the West Germans will say that, after all, we'll have a sort of Finland settlement and call it a day. In which case, that the triumph of the communists set up will be total. And probably the United Kingdom and the other small countries will be forced to fall into the same thing.
Sure. They always talk about what if the Soviet Union said to West Germany, pull out of NATO.
That's right.
And disband your army, and we will allow you to unify with East Germany, and you will have one Germany. Which might be might look wonderful on Monday, but what happens on Tuesday is what we need to remind them, isn't it?
But it is, I mean, this Finlandia word is a word you hear all the time now, and it's been a very clever move of the communists to set this thing up and say, well, look at these people, they're quite happy and so on, you see.
Yes, what's so bad about Finlandization?
Exactly. Actually, we had a team here with to ask about Orwell, and they're frightfully nice people. And I said to them, supposing I say that Orwell's account of things in 1984 and in Animal Farm is based entirely on the arrangements in the Soviet Union, would you allow that to be spoken? And he said, I'm afraid not.
Thank you very much, Mr. Malcolm Muggeridge.
Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and other public television stations. The Mobil Corporation, Dow Chemical Company, John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated, Laurel Foundation, Sunstrand Corporation, and the Friends of Firing Line. This program was produced by SICA, which is solely responsible for its content. For a printed bound transcript of this program, send $3 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina 29250.